Just a minute, guys, because I am not getting my PPTs. Why it is not showing? I don't understand. Just a minute, I will join again. Guys, can you see the PPTs now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Let me start then. Okay. So we were into. Last time, if you remember, we were into the philosophy. We were trying to understand the philosophy, and under that connection, I was dealing with the work that I have carried out. And if you remember, that this is the slide which I last time. Slightly, I modified this particular slide because there was one thing which was missing into it. So, in my PhD work. As I've told you that we solved the problem of metal cyanide waste which is being emanated from the industry, and for that we used the biological method, especially the microbiological method, and this was the theory that we developed during my research work of 6 years, which I've told you last time, where you can see in this particular case that the bond between carbon and nitrogen and the bond between metal and cyanide, it is broken by the bacterial action in the presence of external carbon and air. Okay, so the metal, you can see that the metal and the cyanide part, it gets separated. While the further degradation of the cyanide, it is very well known, but the metal moiety part, it was not known before my studies. So I came up with a theory that that particular kind of a metal which gets separated from the cyanide, either it will get precipitated in the form of a metal hydroxide, which happened in case of copper, zinc and nickel in our studies, while in case of silver, we found that the silver ions which are set aside during the process of degradation, it gets adsorbed onto the bacterial cells. And if you burn the bacterial cells, then ultimately you can recover the silver also. So we could recover silver as well as copper, zinc and nickel through this particular kind of a biochemical kind of a reaction. So this was a theory that it was proved in our laboratory. And this was the, so the formation of metal hydroxide and its recovery in the form of a resource recovery, metal resource recovery. This was a third theory that we proposed as compared to the previous two theories that were reported in the literature, right? So ultimately, so I showed you this particular kind of a figure. So we so I developed this particular kind of a reactor also, which was greatly an engineering part of my research work, even though I was working in the area of microbiology. So last time I had shown you that these are the microbial cells which are there present on the disc. Okay, this is called as a rotating biological contactor, which I had fabricated at that point of time. Okay, in just 500 rupees. So that was a jugaad which I did, right? Then what we did was, in order to see the bacteria that has that is adhered to this particular kind of a disc. Okay, you can see the slimy growth there, and let me tell you that the initial thickness of this particular disc, it was 1 millimeter when we started with the experiment, and over a period of time, the thickness it reached to almost 1 centimeter. Okay, so much thick it became. So we thought that we will see this particular kind of a bacterial film onto scanning electron micrograph. So we subjected the film to the scanning electron micrograph, and here you can see in the topmost picture, this is a disc, polypropylene disc, having lot of pores into it, and it has a magnification of 21.4x. Okay, so you can see there are no microorganisms. In the second figure, you can see that when microorganism they adhere to this particular kind of a disc. So a lot of microorganisms they are there, and then in the another close-up figure at the bottom, you can see that rod-shaped bacteria there onto the disc, right? Then from the philosophical point of view, it was not as I'm continuously telling you that it is not mere analysis of that particular kind of a cyanide into the wastewater, whether it has got diminished or whether it is there in the wastewater. After treatment also, we thought that we should investigate the treated effluent of copper cyanide, zinc cyanide, and other kind of a cyanide in the treated effluent with the fish species, because fish is considered to be as a most sensitive organism in the aquatic segment. So we tested in triplicate and 10-10 organisms in each of the concentration, the treated effluent. Okay, so we took 100% of the treated effluent, we diluted it 50 times also, 10 times also, and in every dilution we tested 10 organisms, and the acute toxicity test, it was carried out, and we found that in the period of 96 hours, all the organisms, they survived. Okay, there were not a single death. And even though I have not shown the data of actual copper cyanide and zinc cyanide, we found that when actual copper cyanide and zinc cyanide and other type of cyanide, they were used without treatment, all the fishes, they died in first 15 to 20 minutes. Okay, but the treated effluent, none of them they died, which confirms that cyanide, it is not there in the solution, and it is safe to discharge. So the process that we developed, okay, it was having a following advantages. It did not require any expensive chemical additives, okay, which saved the cost. No aeration was required. Very little or no pH adjustment was required. The process developed a low volume of sludge in terms of biomass, which could be recycled, so it is not a waste. Then process was very easy to operate and maintain, and the most important thing, that the metal which was present in the waste, it could be recovered in the form of a resource. Hi, Akash. Okay, so this work that we carried out was of interdisciplinary nature, and it involved disciplines like microbiology, biotechnology, chemistry, toxic waste management, engineering, resource recovery, metallurgy, climate change, and economics. So we also carried out the economics of this process, and we found that almost for we found, I don't remember the figures now, but we found that this particular kind of a process, it is 5 to 10 times cheaper as compared to the conventional methods that were used for the treatment of cyanide. Okay, so in the work that I have carried out during my PhD, there was a theoretical development also and there was a process development. Okay, so we elucidated this particular kind of aspects during my PhD work, right? Now see, as I always say that no PhD work it is complete. Even after completing my PhD, I myself identified several research questions from my own research work, okay, and which I am trying to address it even today, even 21 years of completion of my PhD work, okay. So what are the directions for future research after completion of my PhD, and like for example, what will be the fate of metal cyanide biodegradation using fungal and algal cultures? Can metal cyanide be removed from solution using sorption process instead of degradation? Can metal parts, the metal cyanide, be removed by binding on cells? Can cyanide be converted to thiocyanate and then degraded efficiently by microorganisms? So you can see the range of questions that I have come up with from my own research work. Okay, this is called to be as identifying gaps from the research. Okay, and as a PhD student, you need to also identify the gaps that have been carried in your niche area when you will be reading the research papers of others. These gaps I have found it, I have identified from my own research, and I am still working on them, right? And see, so many questions are there. So as a PhD student, as a researcher, it is necessary for you to be very, very curious in nature, to ask the questions, okay? And it is very important to ask the questions, and probably you may not be able to resolve all the questions during your PhD tenure, but then it will be sufficient for you to, for your entire life in future at the same time, right? So out of so many questions that I have asked myself for my PhD work, I have already solved almost 4 to 5 questions in last 21 years based upon my PhD work as such, right? So this is the way how you have to identify the gaps from the research work that have been carried out already, and then you have to take one or couple of questions together to address that particular kind of a research gaps through your research work, right? So the point that I am trying to make is why I've told you this entire story, for the simple reason that how you have to think from the philosophical point of view as far as your research it is concerned, and not from the analytical point of view, right? Now, so I will give you another simple example. Okay, now see, what do you mean by synthetic interpretation, and what do you mean by mere analytical approach? Okay, mere analytical approach would be like, let us say, a chemistry person or a chemistry scholar or student. He is just going onto the sides of the lake, okay, the side of the lake or a river. He will just collect the water from that particular kind of a river or a lake, right? And he will estimate the amount of dissolved oxygen that is present in that particular kind of a water, okay. Now, performing this particular kind of activity by a chemist, okay, or a chemistry scientist or a chemistry researcher or a chemistry student or as a PhD student, it is just an analytical part. There is no philosophy in this particular case. You have just analyzed it. There is no doubt that you might have analyzed it very correctly. You have used a proper methodology in order to estimate the dissolved oxygen that is present in the water, okay. And you might have used a standard method like Winkler's method in order to find out the dissolved oxygen that is present in the water. You might have collected the sample in a scientific manner. Scientifically, you have analyzed it, and ultimately you have got a answer that the water that is flowing in the river or the water that is present in the lake from where you have collected the sample, okay, it consists of dissolved oxygen to the tune of only 2 mg per liter. Okay, that is your analysis, right? Now, you are not making, now see, you have analyzed and you have found that it is 2 milligram per liter, right? But as a researcher, even though you are a chemist, but one has to think as a researcher and from the philosophical angle, that fine, okay, a person like my might ask the question that fine, that you have collected the sample from so and so river or a lake and you have analyzed the dissolved oxygen. The method applied by you was absolutely right and you have ultimately found that there is a 2 milligram per liter of oxygen in that particular kind of a water. Okay. Probably you might have analyzed it several times and every time you find that it is in the range of 1.5 to 2 milligram per liter of dissolved oxygen. Now, the question that I would ask you is that, so what? Okay, fine, it is 1.5 or 2 milligram per liter. But what next? Okay, what is the significance of this particular kind of a analysis or analytical approach that you have used in order to find out the oxygen that is there? Definitely your objective was to find out the oxygen, but then it was a mere analysis. Ultimately, you have to synthetically interpret those particular kind of a result. Okay, so how you will synthetically interpret that particular kind of a result based upon your thought process, the availability of the knowledge, okay, your experience, okay, by asking research questions and several other kind of a things, whatever that we have seen under philosophy and wisdom that we have in the last couple of sessions, right? So that 2 milligram per liter of oxygen in the water, it means a lot. It means that it is not conforming with the legal limits or the limits that are prescribed by the statutory agencies of that particular nation. Like for example, in India, we are in India. So the statutory agency in India is Ministry of Environment, Forest, Climate Change, or Maharashtra Pollution Control Board or Central Pollution Control Board. The norm of the dissolved oxygen in the river or a lake, it should be something around 4 to 5 milligram per liter. But then you are short of 2 there. Got the point? Second thing is that the oxygen that is dissolved in the water, it never reacts with the water for that matter. Okay. It is based upon the Henry's law, right? So it is temperature dependent. Higher the temperature, less will be the dissolved oxygen in that particular kind of a water, right? And low will be the temperature, higher will be the oxygen concentration. But then as far as temperature it is concerned, while analyzing the oxygen, dissolved oxygen from the water, you have not noted down the temperature, okay? But even if you have noted it down, and let us say that temperature is around 25 degrees of Celsius, okay, then it is fine, okay? But then, again the problem lies is that still it is not meeting the regulatory standard, okay? Then what about the aquatic life that is present in the water? Like for example, fish. Fish is considered to be as a most sensitive animal or organism in the aquatic arena, okay? The survival of the fish, it is completely dependent upon the amount of dissolved oxygen that is present in the water, right? But the minimum amount of oxygen that is required for the survival of the fishes in the water, it is in the range of 4 to 5 milligram per liter. It means that the dissolved oxygen content or concentration in the lake or in the water body, it should be more than 5 milligram per liter. But in your case, you have found it is only 2 milligram per liter. So fishes cannot survive. It means that you have to also see that there is some kind of a contamination which is happening in that particular kind of a water body. Okay, if contamination is happening or pollution is happening, then the next question is from where it is happening. Okay, and it also means that there is a lot of organic matter that is present in the waste. Okay, because organic matter, it consumes lot of, huge amount of oxygen that is already present in the water body. Is that clear? And therefore, it is necessary to resolve this particular kind of a problem from the philosophical angle. Okay, it is not mere from the analytical point of view. And accordingly, you have to find out the solutions to this particular kind of a problem. And the solution could be like how you would, so the question, the logic, obvious question or logical question or a philosophical question that could come, that how you would ensure to increase the dissolved oxygen level in the water up to 5 milligram per liter. Okay, so see, there are so many things which are linked with the oxygen that is present in the water. Okay, almost another dozen of points I have not told you. I have just told you 4 to 5 different points based upon the dissolved oxygen. There are many other points also. Okay, so as a research student, you need to think from this particular kind of a angle. I hope now the concept is very, very clear. तर थोडक्यात सांगायचं तर इन अदर वर्ड्स जेव्हा पी एच डी का वर्क करोगे तो यू हॅव टू थिंक फ्रॉम द 360 डिग्रीज. ओके, 360 डिग्री अँगल, इट इज अ व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट कन्सेप्ट इन द फील्ड ऑफ मॅनेजमेंट सायन्स, राईट? सो लेट अस मूव अहेड विथ दिस. इज दिस क्लिअर टू यू ऑल गाईज?
यस सर,
यस सर,
या.
Yes, sir.
So yes, okay. So so let us move ahead from philosophy to ethics. Okay, ultimately they are connected to each other, and let us understand something about ethics. What do you mean by ethics as such? What do you mean by moral philosophy? What is the nature of moral judgments and the reactions that are there? Okay. So let us come to the ethical part of it. Ethics, when you say ethics as a concept, ethics is also called to be as a moral philosophy. We'll come to that. What is moral and what is ethics? Philosophy, you know it, because we have been discussing it for the last almost 2 to 3 sessions. So basically, ethics, it is a branch of philosophy. So we have understood by this time that what do you mean by this philosophy in a larger context, and you are very well aware that it is nothing but a rational, it is a rational attempt. Remember, it is not a subjective attempt or any other kind of attempt. It is completely a rational attempt to formulate, understand and answer fundamental questions. Okay, and remember one thing, that when you are ethical in nature, then you when see how this ethics and this philosophy is connected, right? On one hand, we say that philosophy is a rational attempt to formulate, understand and answer fundamental questions. See, I am stressing upon this fundamental question. Okay, like, because in your research work also you will be asking the fundamental questions. Okay, so how this fundamental question and the rational attempt of asking the fundamental question, it is linked with the ethics here in this particular case, right? Because unless and until, as a human being, as a student, if you are not ethical enough, now what is that ethics, we will come to that, but if you are not ethical enough by any means, so if that is the case, then probably you may not ask a fundamental question. Okay, to yourself. And if you cannot ask the fundamental question to yourself, then probably you may not be able to resolve or solve that particular kind of a fundamental question through your research work. That is what I am trying to say. Are you getting this particular point, students? Main kya bolna chah raha hu, aapke dhyan mein aa raha hai? Sagarna samajhta hai?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You can ask me the question in between, huh?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, have you understood this concept? Rational attempt of asking a fundamental question. Okay. मान लो कि आप अगर ethical नहीं हो, okay, आपके behavior से, because ethics is about your behavior, about your character, about your moral culture, okay, about your values, that is there. If you are not there, then probably you may not ask the fundamental question. Okay. This is the way, this is the important crux or a central dogma, what I would say, and the interlinkages between the ethics and philosophy. And therefore, ethics, it is a branch of philosophy. Okay. So, ye ethics ki baat kahan se aa gayi? Why we are studying this particular kind of ethical stuff, okay, in the PhD coursework? because you might be wondering that यार suddenly हमने तो पिछले बैच से बैच के स्टूडेंट से पूछा कि पीएचडी कोर्स में क्या क्या पढ़ाया, तो ये तो एथिक्स की कोई बात थी नहीं उसके अंदर, बराबर है. एंड सडनली हाउ कम इट हैज कम दिस ईयर, राइट. एंड एज आई टोल्ड यू इन माई प्रीवियस सेशंस एज वेल दैट यूजीसी हैज वेरी रिसेंटली इनकॉर्पोरेटेड अ टू क्रेडिट कोर्स ऑन द फिलोसॉफी एंड एथिक्स ऑफ रिसर्च. एंड एज फार एज योर पीएचडी कोर्स वर्क इट इज कंसर्न, आई एम टीचिंग यू दिस एंटायर टू क्रेडिट का कोर्स वर्क. लेकिन अब हम लोग क्यों पढ़ रहे हैं इसके लिए? Now see the scenario that was there maybe 20 or 30 years back or even beyond that, and what is the scenario today? Okay, the scenario 50 years back was that so I'm talking about the period somewhere in 1950s or 60s or maybe 70s, when even I was not born at that point of time, and of course you were not there at that point of time. So the scenario that at that point of time was there were only hard documents which were present, okay, and there was no much information which was available what it is available now on the internet and many other kind of a platforms, okay. There were no such kind of a platforms in 90s and in 1950s and 60s or before that also, and people, the researchers, they were completely engaged, they were completely involved into their research work for years together on a particular kind of a topic, okay. And many good researchers, excellent researchers, they have won the Nobel Prize for that. What the point? So there were no platforms as such, okay. There were no platforms at all, and whatever knowledge that was created, it was really a very original kind of a knowledge that was created or generated by the researchers at that point of time. It doesn't mean that today we are not generating it. Definitely we are generating it. But the difference was that the time taken to create the knowledge at that point of time was large enough when you compare it with in today's context. Okay, what the point? So, because there were no platforms or there were no avenues. But today we have a lot of avenues. Even if you go after 1950s or 60s, or what I would say my generation, okay, because I have already completed my PhD 21 years back. I got my PhD in 1999. But when I started my PhD work, or when I was doing my MSc dissertation in the year 1992-93, okay, that was the period when first time the computers they arrived in Pune. Okay, that was a period 92-93, and I remember that the MSc dissertation copy, it is still there with me. And if I get I'm very happy to give this lectures on online board, but then had there been a physical contact between you and me, had I taught you in the classroom, then I would have shown you all these particular kind of a documents. But then there are certain limitations. But anyway, that time we were using WordStar. There was a, now we use Microsoft Office. That time it was a WordStar, and it was a very pathetic kind of a printing was there. But then my MSc dissertation was in that particular kind of printed in a WordStar. There was no mechanism to draw or plot a graph like what we have today, Excel, or we were unable to draw the tables also. So that was handmade, okay. And if I get the chance, I can show you later on. But then even during my time, the overall avenues or the platforms, they were very, very less. And we used to do literature search physically by going to different libraries, okay. So over a period of time, because of the development of science and technology, you will find that in the 21st century, we have large number of platforms and avenues available with today's student. Okay, which includes internet. Okay, a very powerful kind of a tool. We have Microsoft Office where you do all kind of graphs and tables, right? Documents. You have PowerPoints. You have all sorts of technology and other kind of a thing. So, whatever time that was required 30 years back or 50 years back to do a particular piece of work, the same thing it could be done today within a few days. Okay, let me tell you that my literature search, it took me almost literature search that we carried out, it is a continuous kind of activity, but in order to initiate my work, it took me almost 1.5 years to carry out my literature survey. Okay, by physically going, by photocopying the research papers, by reading, sitting in the library and reading it. Okay, and even in that particular case, you will not believe that I collected almost, I could not get all the full papers. Okay, full papers, what I could get during that particular time was roughly around 200, but total full papers and abstracts that I collected pertaining to my research work or in a subsidiary, it was close to 1100. Could you believe that? Okay. So that is the reason why we say today to all the research students that when you do a literature search, that you have to read at least 200 to 500 research papers. Okay. There is no escape from that. Right. But as I've told you that the literature search, which it took me almost 1.5 years to carry it out, today with all sorts of technology, you can do it within a week. Okay. Even week, I've told you more. Within 3 days, according to me, right? And if you feel as a student that as Yogesh Patil sir kuch bhi bol rahe hai, teen din mein kya literature search hota hai? So I would challenge you rather. So you just give me your dozen keywords, okay, and sit along with me on the computer for a period of 2 to 3 days, and I can give you 500 papers, okay? So literature search, because of technology and other kind of a platforms which are available now, right? It has reduced significantly the time that is required for any kind of a thing. Okay. While it has significantly reduced the time, but at the same time, you will also find that the cases of plagiarism, copying, falsification, it has tremendously increased. So you will find that significant amount of time has reduced to carry out a particular kind of activity, but exponentially you will find that because of these particular kind of a platforms, researchers, they are copying, they are plagiarism, they are doing plagiarism, or they are stealing the others' idea of research and copying it, pasting it, and doing all sorts of things. Okay, and therefore you will find that such kind of incidences, it has increased significantly. You will not believe that hundreds of paper, they are getting retracted on a daily basis that are already published in the journals because of the plagiarism cases. Okay, I will tell you several such kind of cases in my this entire entire tenure of the PhD coursework that I am going to deal with. Okay, and several interesting cases, and therefore you should be very, very careful in such particular case. Okay, it has become a habit to copy the things from other sources. You will not believe that many of the MSc or many of the MSc students, MTech students, or MBA students, they feel that just copying and pasting from the other sources and they prepare the dissertation, it is of no use at all. Okay, rather you write a very original kind of a stuff on your own, right? Of just maybe of 4 to 5 pages, but write it in original. That is very, very important. So the point that I am trying to make is that with the several with the plethora of technologies that have come, okay, in the research field, in every walks of life, you will find that researchers, if they don't have their ethical values, okay, so they are behaving badly, they are behaving in a poor manner, and they are it is ultimately leading to plagiarism, falsification of the data, fabrication of the data, copying or stealing the ideas from other sources, okay, and all sorts of things. They are increasing day by day, and they are increasing exponentially, and therefore it is necessary. It was felt in the academic world that ethics and philosophy should be taught to the new researchers, the budding researchers that are there. Okay, so you are the budding researchers, because PhD degree, for that matter, PhD is the first step of starting with the actual research that is there. Okay, you forget about your research that you have carried out during your graduation and post-graduation. It hardly has got any kind of a value. Okay, in my viewpoint, because it depends upon your mentor also, and the way you have carried out that particular. If you might have done your UGPG dissertation with full commitment and full integrity, okay, full academic integrity and with full interest, then probably your dissertation might be good to some extent. Okay, but otherwise it is of no use, right? But PhD journey, it is a very long journey, and therefore ethics and the research ethics, it should be taught to the students. So what are these ethics and that we are going to see? Got the point? It doesn't mean that 50 years back or 100 years back or maybe 30 years back, there was no copying, there was no plagiarism. Of course, it was there. But because of the availability of the platforms or the avenues, the number of cases, they were very, very few, okay, which you can count it on the fingers. But post, I would say post 1995 or 2000, okay, the number of cases, they have significantly increased, they have exponentially, it has increased. And therefore, a time has come that every PhD student, every researcher, every budding researcher should know about the ethics and the philosophy of the research as such. Okay, and that is the reason why we are here, to make you understand that Baba, ye kya hai philosophy, ye kya hai ethics. Okay, many people, they do PhD, but they don't know what to mean by philosophy as such. And already we have dealt with the philosophy in our last 2 to 3 sessions. Okay, so basically when you talk about the ethics, okay, it is a branch of philosophy, and you know what is philosophy, and I was trying to connect philosophical aspect to the ethics aspect. How ethics, it is a branch of philosophy, wherein in philosophy I was trying to explain you this particular, the meaning of this particular aspect, that you cannot ask the fundamental question unless and until you are rational, or unless and until you are ethical in nature. Okay, so that is a story, and therefore it is a rational attempt to formulate, understand and answer fundamental questions. So in a general sense, philosophy is associated with a wisdom. Okay, and we have seen the various attributes of the wisdom in the last few sessions, and you are very well, I believe that you are very well aware of that. And wisdom, then intellectual culture, how you think from the intellectual point of view, how you avoid the biases, okay, then how do you search for the knowledge, how you think, and all these things, they matter, and what it is called as ethics. So basically it is a synthetic interpretation, and I like this word called as synthesis. Okay, you synthesize the thing. Okay, see, synthesis of the thing, just to elaborate on the meaning of this synthesis of the when you do any kind of a synthesis, whether it is a chemical synthesis or biological synthesis or any kind of a synthesis from the cultural point of view, from social point of view, or from any point of view, it takes a huge time. it takes ample of time, it takes ample of resources, okay, and but it gives you a very kind of a concrete kind of a answer to that particular kind of a synthesis, right? So synthesis, so you can when more than two disciplines they come together, okay, to solve a particular kind of a problem, then it becomes a synthesis of different disciplines. It is an amalgamation of the different types of a discipline in order to resolve that particular kind of a problem from a sustainable point of view. Remember my words, okay? See how I am using the words. So from the sustainable point of view, okay, that answer should be the answer that you are trying to address through your research work, okay? It should be sustainable in nature. It should have a long shelf life. It should lead to another concrete problems that could arrive from your work as such, so that a proper theoretical building it could be built up over a period of time, and which will benefit the entire human beings. And therefore, philosophers, they are philosophers. Okay, हम कितने भी गप्पे मार ले philosophy की, लेकिन हम philosopher नहीं हैं. Got the point? So why Aristotle, Plato, and other people, other great, so many examples I have given you, they are called to be as a philosophers, because they were very very ethical in nature. They were very ethical in nature. Because unless and until you are ethical in nature, you cannot think properly. And if you cannot think properly, you cannot ask the fundamental question. And if you cannot ask fundamental question, you cannot formulate a hypothesis. And you cannot formulate the hypothesis, then you cannot do the work, and you cannot plan your experiment, and the entire thing, it will collapse. Okay, so you remember that these are all the building blocks, okay, of doing a good piece of a research work, and therefore synthesis. Okay, so maan lo ki if you are constructing a building, so it has to have a very strong kind of a base. Okay, so assume that there is a 10 story building. Okay, so how that 10 stories of the building it stands on a very strong base. So that strong base is nothing but the fundamentals, and that fundamentals which includes everything, a strong philosophy, strong morality, strong ethical values, okay, that are there, strong ethical code of conduct that is there, and on that strong theory or a concept, you build the first floor of that. Okay, the first floor it will stand up to it. Unless and until you build the first floor, you cannot construct the second floor. If you cannot, once second floor is there, then unless and until you have a second floor, you cannot construct the third floor. That is the way how the high rise buildings are being made on a very strong foundation. Okay. और जैसे हम बोलते हैं कि लाइक फॉर एग्जांपल एवरी ईयर इन इंडिया वी सी दैट सो मच ऑफ रेन्स दे टेक प्लेस एंड स्पेशली इन द सिटी लाइक मुंबई, हैदराबाद, दिल्ली एंड एवरीवेयर यू विल फाइंड बेंगलोर और चेन्नई एंड इन मेनी अदर प्लेसेस आल्सो इफ द कंस्ट्रक्शन द बिल्डिंग कंस्ट्रक्शन इज वेरी वेरी वीक ओके एंड यू विल फाइंड दैट ड्यूरिंग द रेनी सीजन दीज बिल्डिंग्स दे कोलैप्स this building collapse because they were having a very weak foundation. So usme kuch to bhi corruption kiya hoga, because see, while constructing a building, the mortar that you are using, I hope that you know the mortar is a mixture of stones, sand, then water, cement, and other kind of ingredients which becomes very very tight in the presence of water, and which is used for the construction. It is called as mortar. Okay, so while preparing the mortar for the construction, it is necessary that you have to mix the cement, the sand, stones, and other kind of integrating in the right proportion. Okay, agar wo right proportion agar use nahi kiya gaya, to definitely it will weaken the entire structure and the building it will collapse, isn't it? So a good building, it has a life of 100 years. Lekin aapne dekha hai ki koi building 100 years tak abhi tak rahi hai. The moment it completes 20-25 years, okay, you will find that most of the structures are parts of the building, they become weakened. Okay. It is because of this particular kind of aspect, many people, they are selling the flats and they are shifting to the new buildings every time. So you will find that this cycle, they keep on repeating. But this is not, this cannot happen with the poor people or the middle class people. Those are very rich. They can change the flats, large number of flats. Got the point. But what about the middle age? Well, so while constructing itself, philosophically it was not thought, because usme fayda dekha gaya, only the money part it was seen, and lot of corruption it happened, and then that is the reason why the building it collapsed. Okay, so this ethics and the philosophy teaches you to have a sound and a concrete kind of a base, so that you can lay the proper foundation and other floors on that particular kind of a foundation that you have at the base. Okay, so building banane mein, you take on an average, any building of maybe 10 or 12 story, it takes something around 1.5 to 2 years. Okay, once it gets built up, then you go and stay there. But then demolishing the building, it hardly takes any time. Got the point? Ek bomb rakh do uske andar and you can demolish the building. Got the point? So demolishing, it will take hardly any time, but synthesis, it takes huge amount of time. You imagine that the food that you eat daily, hum palak ki sabji khate hai, methi ki sabji khate hai, mirchi khate hai, so many different vegetable stuff that we are eating. And if you see the growth of these particular vegetables, whether it is a leafy or non-leafy kind of a vegetables, every vegetable, it takes minimum 3 to 4 months for its cultivation, okay, to reach to its optimum growth. Got the point? And then it is being harvested, then it comes to you, or fir aap kya within few minutes, or in a half an hour or 1 hour, you prepare the sabji. In next 20 minutes you eat it, in next 8 hours you digest it. Got the point? मतलब वो सब्जी जिसको ग्रो होने के लिए 4 से 5 महीने लगे, दैट यू फिनिश इट विद इन फ्यू डे, विद इन फ्यू आवर्स. गॉट द पॉइंट? सो सिंथेसिस, इट टेक्स लॉट ऑफ टाइम. डिस्ट्रक्शन, इट डजंट टेक मच टाइम. गॉट द पॉइंट? एंड देयरफॉर बिल्डिंग अ सिंथेसिस इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू सस्टेन द ओवरऑल फैब्रिक ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ अ सोसाइटी दैट इज देयर. ओके, एंड इट इज फॉर दिस रीजन दैट why one needs to study ethics. इसलिए ethical values पढ़ाना अभी बहुत जरूरी हो गया है. What the point? So, what is this ethic? It is relating to one's character, as I mentioned on the slide. Okay, character or a moral nature that is there. And as far as if you see this particular word ethics, originally it was a Latin word. And over a period of time, you will find that that particular kind of a word, it moved from Latin to French, from French then it moved to English, and then ultimately in English the word ethics, it came into the picture, right? That was the journey of this particular kind of ethics. And different authors, they have defined ethics in a different way. Like Rashwat Kidder, what he says, that the science of ideal human character. Okay. See, idealistic, when you say ideal, he is an ideal human being. Normally in a colloquial, in our routine language, we say, "Arey, that person is an ideal human being." It means that he is very good, he is very kind, he helps the people, something like that. Okay, there are certain characteristics, there are certain properties, there are certain kind of a salient features of that particular kind of a human being. So Rashwat Kidder, he says that it is a science of the ideal human character. What kind of a character or a values that particular kind of a human he or she has got. On the other hand, the Richard William Paul and Linda Elder, what they say is that it is a set of concepts and principles that guide us in determining what behavior helps or harms sentient creatures. That is there. In other words, what they are talking about is the moral principles. What kind of a principles are there? Because there are certain set of principles in every religion, in every caste, in every nation. Okay, and these principles, they guide us, because no religion is bad as such. Okay, this I have told you last time also. All religions, they tell us the good thing, whether it is a Hindu, Muslim, Christianity, Jewish, or whatever it may be, right? But then the individual human values, okay, that plays a very, very important role when you divert from the pathways or the concepts and the principles that have been given, given to us by a particular religion or a humanity. That is it. Okay, so depending upon that particular kind of a behavior, it helps to the others, or probably it harms to the creatures. Okay, so basically they are the moral principles that are there. Okay, then ethics is also synonymously, it is called as a moral philosophy. Okay, philosophy, we know, it is a rational, as you know that it is a rational way of asking the research questions, or attempt to ask the research question. So moral and ethics, they are almost one and the same. And as I've told you that it is a branch of a philosophy, but basically it involves systematizing, defending and recommending concepts of right and wrong behavior. Okay, see, there is deep meaning which is involved in this particular words. It involves systematizing, defending and recommending concepts of right and wrong behavior. Okay, now what do you mean by this? Okay, it involves systematizing, defending and recommending the concepts. Now see, there are in human environment, while nature has its own laws, okay, nature has its own principles and laws that are there, but when you talk about the human environment as such, where the because human has a intellectual property or intellectual capital that is there, and you will find that for centuries together, humans, they have created their own kind of environment, and in that particular kind of environment, over a period of time, eventually with the time, you will find that different religions, they have come into being, right? Like Christianity, Jainism, okay, Muslim, Hindus, Hinduism, okay, and several others. There are so many of them are there. So in that also, you will find that at the same time, every nation, they have all these particular kind of religions that are there. Okay, in India, you will find that we have Christians, we have Muslims, we have Hindus, we have many people from other religions as well, right? At the same time, as a nation, you will find that the nation in itself, it has in the human environment, you will find that there are different segments they have created, and in each of those particular kind of segment, they have a different role to play. Okay, like for example, military is one such kind of a segment. Okay, so Indian military, so armed forces, we have a navy, we have an air force, right? And they have their own set of principles. Okay, so it means that when you talk about the ethics and moral philosophy, it involves systematizing, defending the things. Okay, so as a military as a whole, what is the role of the military for any nation? It is to protect the countries, protect the borders of that particular kind of a country from the invasion of any enemy. Okay, so basically their role is, it is very well defined, okay, to protect the nation, and therefore they have created their own set of principles, right, in order to protect the nation. So let us say if when they are fighting with the enemy on the border, So their set of principle, it says that when you have a enemy in front of you, okay, and suppose if you are fighting, then definitely you have to bullet him. It means that you have to shot him dead, right? By using a gun. Got a point? So a soldier, whatever he is doing on the border, killing the enemy, it is the ethics from their point of view. Got the point? Because military, they have their own defense mechanism. They have their own role to play. They have created their own set of principles. They have created their systematic processes. Okay. They have used different types of concepts that are there. And based upon this systematization, defending and recommending concepts, the right behavior on the border is that when the enemy is there in front of a soldier, he will kill him, okay, with his gun. Got the point? Because their set of principles, okay, their processes, they guide them that you have to perform this particular kind of activity, and which is an ethical kind of activity, or it is, in other words, it is a moral philosophy that you have to kill the soldier if you find him encroaching into our borders, right? But then if the same soldier tomorrow, he comes in the classroom, okay, let us say where I am teaching or any other teacher is teaching, and he suddenly uses his gun and trying to kill the students or people, those who are sitting in there, is that ethical? No, it is not ethical there. So a soldier coming into the classroom and hitting, beating or shooting to the people or the students, those who are sitting in the classroom hearing the teacher, it is a wrong behavior. On the other hand, when the soldier, he or she, they are there on the border when they are killing the enemy, then that is a right behavior. Okay. So ethics is about all these particular things. So where you are there, okay, at which place you are there, in which role you are there, which what are the guiding principles, under which framework you are working, that plays a very important role as far as ethics they are concerned. I hope you are getting the point, guys. No answers, yes, from the other end. Are you listening to me, really?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes sir.
Yes sir.
अरे क्या सो गए? नहीं ना?
Yes sir.
You all are listening. Okay.
Yes sir.
सो मत जाना. वैसे मैं सोने नहीं दूंगा आपको. Anyway, have you understood this concept? The ethical behavior or the moral philosophy on the border, it is different for the soldier, okay, and the ethical behavior in the classroom by the same soldier. So at one place his behavior is right, on the other place his behavior is wrong. Is that clear? Right. Now same thing is applicable for your research work as well, right? While writing a research paper, you should not copy, while preparing the manuscript, you should not copy it from the other sources. Okay, कि इसने ये कंसेप्ट लिखा था, यू कॉपी दैट पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ अ पैराग्राफ दैट इज देयर. गॉट द पॉइंट? सो व्हाइल राइटिंग अ रिसर्च मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट, द एथिकल बिहेवियर दैट यू आर फॉलोइंग, कॉपिंग इट फ्रॉम द अदर रिसर्च पेपर्स एंड स्लाइटली मॉडिफाइंग इट, इट इज अ रॉन्ग बिहेवियर, इट इज अनएथिकल इन नेचर. ओके, गॉट द पॉइंट? बट सपोज इफ यू आर राइटिंग अ article for a newspaper or a magazine, let us say, right, there the approach is different, because while writing an article for a newspaper on a particular kind of a findings or a research findings, definitely you will see 10 different research papers or 100 research different research papers, and you will make a story. So it means that you are copying the ideas from, you are taking the ideas from that particular kind of research paper, and the same idea you are putting it in a very simple language for the general readership that is there. Okay, so there your ethical behavior is right, because you are writing it for the masses, you are making it in a simple language. Okay, you are not writing a research paper there. You want to, because research paper is very difficult to understand for a layman or a general public. So let us say, as a reporter, okay, as a researcher, because many researchers, they write articles in the newspaper, they give talks on to the radio. Even I have done it. I have given a couple of talks on the All India Radio, right? Even I have written articles in the newspaper about my own research paper, my research that is there. At the same time, other reporters, they also write the articles. So here, the set of principles that are guiding us in the different kind of activities, they are altogether different. Got the point? So as a researcher, if you want to write it in a newspaper for the general public, definitely you will copy the stuff from the research papers, okay, and write it in a simple language. But while writing a research manuscript for publishing, okay, you cannot steal the idea of others and write it in your research paper. Rather, you have to write your own research work, okay, the original research work that you have carried out, okay, and then you have to send it to the journal for publication. So these are two different activities, wherein in one case you can copy the things, while in other case you cannot copy the things. Got the point? Is it just like a soldier, the example which I have given you? Got the point? So broadly speaking, when you talk about the ethics, okay, it addresses the issues related to the concepts of right and wrong, okay, because all the concepts, they cannot be right in all the different situations that are there. Because see, as a human being, you come across different type of situations. Got the point? And everywhere, if you are doing the same kind of activity, it may not be right or it may not be wrong. It depends upon that particular kind of a context. Okay. So, but your thought process or your thought process or your thinking in a right manner or a wrong manner, okay, it will depend upon how you are as a person. What are your values? Okay, whether you are being properly guided by the set of principles that are already existing in that particular kind of a fraternity. Okay, so you can say that research, the pool of researchers, it is a very big fraternity, the academicians. Okay, we have our own set of principles. Under that set of principles, as a research student, you have to act accordingly. Okay, so what is right and wrong there? And therefore, normative ethics, it is also being referred to as a moral theory. Okay, and focuses on how moral values are determined, what makes the thing right or wrong, and what should be done at that point of time. Right? So this is the fundamental concept of the ethics, which involves systematic defending and recommending concepts that are there. Okay? Now, these particular kind of a concept, I will come to that particular part in the later stages, which has come from several different segments that are there. So basically, ethics, it tries to resolve questions of human morality. Okay? And these human moralities are based upon certain concepts. What are those concepts, like good or evil? Okay, what, good things, bad things, evil actions, good actions. Okay, you know it very well. I don't have to explain you this. What do you mean by good and what do you mean by evil? And it is not about only the human beings. Okay, but there are chemicals also which has got an evil reputation, right? Like there is a huge evil reputation of a chemical like cyanide or pesticide. And you will find, if you just Google it, you will find that several cyanide related, pesticide related accidents have taken place in the past. Okay, but then why these accidents, they were taken place? Under what circumstances these accidents were taken place? Because there was a human intervention there. Okay, and wherever there is a human intervention, their philosophy and ethics, they play a very, very important role. Okay, Bhopal gas tragedy. How did it happen? Okay, are you aware of that as a engineering students? Are you aware Bhopal gas tragedy?
Guys? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What was the responsible chemical because of which the Bhopal gas tragedy took place?
Methyl isocyanide.
Yeah, it is the organic cyanide or inorganic cyanide.
Sir, it is organic.
Ah, very good. Okay, so it happened because of the methyl isocyanate. Okay, and almost more than 10 to 20,000 people they died. Actually, the number is very big, but the number was reported very less. But I believe that probably at that point of time you were not born. I have witnessed that particular kind of happening because I was there in 9th standard at that point of time, okay, in 1984. So, why this methyl isocyanate accident or Bhopal gas tragedy, it happened in India, which killed so many people? Because of the human behavior, right? There were three control mechanisms in the Bhopal, what is that industry? I forgot the name, but it was a carbamate industry. Carbamate pesticides was synthesized there, and there were three control mechanisms. The first control mechanism was what? The caustic soda plant. The second, not caustic soda plant, that was the second one. The first one was the nitrogen jacket, okay, the cold nitrogen jacket around that particular kind of a containers where methyl isocyanate or MIC it was stored. The second was the caustic soda plant, and the third was the flare tower. Okay. Unfortunately, on 3rd of December, between the 2nd and 3rd, the night between the 2nd and 3rd December 1984, all these three control mechanisms, they were not working. Because of the sheer negligence of the people, those who are working in that carbamate factory. Okay. Because methyl isocyanate is such kind of a chemical which is capable of reacting with itself even at a normal room temperature. And since the nitrogen jacket plant, it was not working, it was not functional. It was not functioning that day. The methyl isocyanate in the tanks, it started boiling because it reacts with itself, okay, and it started boiling, and then it raised the pressure, okay, and unfortunately the caustic soda plant also, it was not working on that particular day, right, because it neutralizes the methyl isocyanate, and then later on even the flare tower to burn that particular gas, it was also not working, and because of which huge amount of methyl MIC it was released into the atmosphere, and rest is the history as you know it. So it is an evil repetition of that particular chemical. Okay, but remember one thing, whatever evil things that have happened in nature, okay, or what nature is causing, and the evil repetition that has happened in the human environment or this technological, so-called technological society, it is all because of the human intervention, and there the philosophy and the ethical aspects, they completely went wrong, and that is the reason why this happened. Okay, got the point? Now fine, it happened, but then we need to learn something from that, isn't it? But it seems that we haven't learned from it, and still you will find that even in this COVID-19 pandemic, you will find that I remember that two or three major fires, they took place in the various industries. One was somewhere in Surat, one was somewhere in the south, one was in near Pune called in which that industrial area. Near Pune, there is a place on 80 kilometers. There is one industrial belt. There also one of the industry caught the fire. Okay, it means that we are not trying to learn from such kind of accidents that have taken place. Of course, there were no casualties, but then remember, huge amount of resources they got lost in these particular kind of accidents, right? So good and evil, it plays an important role. What is right or wrong? Okay, need not to explain you what is right in a particular situation and what is wrong in a particular situation. It might be right for one thing, it might be wrong for the other thing. Okay, what is the virtue and vice? Right, virtue is nothing but the credentials that are there. We say that that particular person has a very good credentials, he has a good virtue. Okay, it is that way. It is just like a, he has got a wisdom, something like that. Then justice and crime. Okay, so what ethics is trying to do is, when you do ethical kind of a research, or the those who are actually many of the social science people, they do a lot of research in the area of ethics, and they try to resolve such kind of a questions between what is good and what is evil, right, wrong, virtue, vice, justice, crime, something like that. Okay, so basically it is a field of intellectual inquiry, and therefore you will find that this ethics, there are many several subfields under the ethics, such as moral psychology, then descriptive ethics and value theory. Okay, so we will not go into the details of this particular kind of a moral psychology or descriptive ethics or value theory as such, but then these are the branches of ethics, and a significant piece of research it is being carried out in this particular kind of a area, right? There are certain misconceptions about the ethics as given by Paul and Elder in 2006. Okay, because many people, actually it should be many, I have written may there, sorry for that. Many people confuse ethics with behaving in accordance with social conventions, religious belief, and according to the law. Okay, this is one of the biggest conception. Okay, because see, remember one thing, that all the guidelines and the principles, or the set of principles that are there, from the religion point of view, from the social conventions point of view, okay, there are certain religious belief, there are so many superstitions, superstitious people, okay, there are laws. Remember one thing, that all these things, they are not correct in itself, even though as per this particular kind of a definition, as you can see at the top, it involves systematizing, defending and recommending concepts of right and wrong behavior. Okay, because over a period of time, for centuries together, the society or the people in that particular society, they have tried to define that what are our conventions, what are our beliefs and other kind of a things, and they have created their own set of principles and laws and other kind of a things. Okay, but when you talk about ethics or the values from the personal point of view, okay, so it doesn't mean that if you are following a particular kind of a law, it means that you are right in that particular case, right? So you have to keep aside the entire beliefs, social conventions and the law that is there. On the other hand, ethics is a stand-alone kind of a concept. Okay, agar law ke hisab se aap log chal rahe ho, to it doesn't mean that you are ethical in nature. Okay, what I am trying to tell you. Okay, haan, ye law to ye kehta hai. Many times in a very routine, in our routine life we say, but law is saying this, so it doesn't mean that you are behaving ethically. It depends upon your values also. And therefore, ethics as a concept, it is a stand-alone kind of a concept in a given scenario. That is there, which I have explained you in the last few slides as such. So basically, it is a study of, in short, it is a study of what is right or wrong in human behavior. Okay, because ultimately, aapko ye sochna hai as a research student, as a PhD student, कि अल्टीमेटली व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट द लॉज, व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट द रिलीजियस बिलीव्स, द कन्वेंशंस, द सेट ऑफ प्रिंसिपल्स, वॉट एवर इट, ये अल्टीमेटली बनाया किसने? ये ह्यूमन ने तो बनाया है, इज़न्ट इट? राइट? सो इफ यू सी द ओरिजिन ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ अ सेट ऑफ प्रिंसिपल्स, हाउ दे वर क्रिएटेड बाय द ह्यूमन देमसेल्व्स, इज़न्ट इट? एंड ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम एज what it happens in case of research also, the concept developed by one, it was modified and refined by the other researchers, okay, and over a period of time it got modified, it got refined more and more, and whatever set of principles we say to ki hindu logo mein aisa kaha jata hai, hinduism it says something like this, Christianity says something like this, okay. But you will find that all the religions, they are talking about good things. What the point? So basically all these things, they were created by the human, and therefore human behavior, it plays a very very important role. So you see the scientific discoveries also that have happened, the key discoveries that have happened in for centuries together, or the philosophy that have been created, it has always been done by the great people. Okay, and if you read their history, right from Aristotle, Plato, Nietzsche, Kant, and many Indian other philosophers, Swami Vivekananda, and many others. Okay, there are plethora of philosophers that are there. Over a period of time, they have created this particular kind of things. Okay, and they followed the ethical principles. Their values that were there, and therefore they could develop so much of philosophy and the scientific discoveries that have done. So that is the reason why we are enjoying so many scientific discoveries in the 21st century. I am sitting here and delivering a lecture online to y'all. अभी मेरे table के ऊपर phone है. I have a printer. I can scan. It is 3-in-1 scanner and everything. I have a very good PC here. Okay, so most of the things, they are there. We have a laboratories and other kind of a things. So see, scientific discoveries over a period of time, it has done a lot of wonders, because every researcher, every scientist, every philosopher, they thought from the point of view of the betterment of the human being. Got the point? You will not believe how Edison almost so many patents he has got on his name. Okay, Edison, Tesla, many other scientists, Einstein, then Faraday, and many others. Okay, and almost the entire breed of the scientists, because they thought from the humanity point of view. And actually, if you see, they have improved our life, but the way they carried out the work at that point of time, it was in a very pathetic kind of a condition. You will not believe the condition of the Alexander Fleming's laboratory, then Edison's laboratory. It was completely a mess, and in that mess they were doing research. Got the point? And they have done such a fantastic piece of research work. Okay, if they can do it in a messy kind of a environment, why can't we do with so much of facilities good piece of research work? That point needs to be thought of, isn't it? Do you agree with me? Are kuch bolo?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, whatever is being done on in this human environment, it has been done by the human behavior. Okay, got the point? And beliefs about what is morally correct and acceptable in the given conditions. Okay, this is in short what do you mean by the ethics as such. Got the point? Now there are different terms there, so you need to understand the minor differences between these, but you will find that more or less they are one and the same. You can see more what do you mean by more moral ethics, ethical code, values, ethical values that are there. Okay, so when you talk about ethics or moral, and as I've told you, moral philosophy and ethics, they are one and the same. So moral is nothing but the guiding principles. Okay, as I've told you, that concerned with what is right and wrong, and they are based upon certain kind of a standards. Okay, yes, standards. Because when you talk about any kind of a standard from the ethical point of view or from moral point of view, the standards of good that is there. Okay. मतलब जैसे हिंदुइज्म लोगों में है, हिंदू लोगों में है, या द कल्चर दैट वी फॉलो, फॉरगेट अबाउट हिंदुइज्म और जैनिज्म और क्रिश्चियनिटी और एनी अदर काइंड ऑफ रिलीजन, बट एज अ ह्यूमन, ओके, व्हेन यू आर देयर इन योर हाउस एंड इफ सम गेस्ट कम टू यू, सो यू ग्रीट हिम, इफ यू आर एथिकल देन यू विल ग्रीट हिम, यू विल इन्वाइट हिम टू, यू विल टेक हिम इनसाइड. Okay, you will greet him, you will give him water, okay, you will give him tea, right? You will also force him to have lunch or dinner, whatever it may be. Okay, so you treat them in a very good fashion, right? Because that particular kind of a, so these are the standards of you call it any kind of a religion for that matter. Okay, so you consider atithi as a devo bhav. Okay, so atithi aapke ghar mein jo aata hai is just like a god. Okay, so you greet him and you give all you feel you make him comfortable. Okay, you give him food and any other kind of a thing. So so you give all kind of a respect to that particular person. So you follow that particular kind of a moral principles there, because there are certain standards. ओके, तो हम लोग ये ऐसा क्यों करते हैं कि गेस्ट आया तो वी बिहेव वेरी राइटली इन अ गुड मैनर, वी ग्रीट हिम, वी गिव हिम फूड, वी गिव हिम वाटर, वी टॉक टू हिम, वी रिस्पेक्ट हिम, ओके, सुख दुख की बातें करते हैं, जो कुछ भी है, राइट? बिकॉज फॉर सेंचुरीज टुगेदर दिस पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ वैल्यूज दे हैव गॉट ट्रांसफर्ड फ्रॉम द टॉप मोस्ट फिलोसोफर्स दैट वर देयर. And it has got transferred from generation to generation. Okay, just like the Bhagavad Gita, which was told by Shri Krishna to Arjun. Okay, it has got transferred from generation to generation. And whatever Bhagavad Gita we learn, so the entire philosophy of the entire life, it is given in that particular kind of a Bhagavad Gita. So it tells us that how one should behave in a particular kind of a condition. Okay, got the point? So ethics, they are the nothing but just they are also kind of a guiding principles. They are the specific rules and the actions and behavior in a particular kind of a condition. Okay, like military ke people, the people those who are there in the military, they will behave in a different manner when they are there in their vicinity. Okay, the people those who are there in the hospital, they will behave differently. Got the point? The people those who are there in their own house, they will behave differently. When I am in the office, I will behave differently. Got the point? Just excuse me. Hello. Yeah, Pali. I know. I will answer your mail. Right now, I am in a lecture. So I will talk to you later on, or I will drop a mail. Yeah. Thanks. So. The people those who are in the hospital, doctors, they behave differently, nurses, they behave differently, patients, they behave differently because they're in that particular kind of a, so you will find that in every entity of the human environment, different people, they behave differently in a different kind of a situation that is there. Okay, and there are certain specific rules and accordingly you have to follow those particular kind of a rules that are there. So that is about the moral and ethics that is there. So ethical code is nothing but the set of rules that defines allowable actions or correct behavior. जैसे मैंने आपको soldier का example लिया, right? Soldier when he is on border, he will fight with his enemy. Okay. If the same soldier comes in the classroom as a student, then he has to study, isn't it? But he cannot do the same kind of activity what he did in the border. Got the point? So ethical code is about the set of rules that have been delivered. So certain actions, they are allowed in a certain places. Okay, what it is called as correct behavior, or they are also called to be as a allowable kind of actions that are there. Okay, and then you have a values, and these values, they are more personal in nature. On the other hand, when you talk about moral ethics and ethical code and other kind of a things, it is the guiding principles of a particular kind of an entity that is there, and these particular kind of a guiding principles have been developed over a period of time, based upon the experience, the thought process, research, okay, and a lot of other kind of a things. Based upon this set of principles, they have been created, and these particular set of principles, they tell the individual that you have to behave in this particular kind of a, you are only allowed to do such kind of actions when you are there in the military or in the hospital or when you are in the university, when you are in the classroom, or when you are in the market, okay, something like that. Got the point? So jaise maan lo ki soldier ne uske duty, agar if he doesn't perform his duty when he is in the military, then immediately he has to face the court martial in that case, right? But on the other hand, when you talk about the values, while set of principles and guiding principles, they are there at place, okay, on one hand, and who will guide those particular kind of principles? Of course, the humans, those who are there in that particular kind of environment, right? But then certain times, when you talk about ethicals, ethical behavior, it is more about human behavior, and that human behavior, it depends upon its values that is there. So what is the motive behind the purposeful kind of action that is there, which may be considered as a moral, right? So if a soldier is very good, then he will fight with the enemy. If the soldier is not good, he has something wrong in his mind, he might give a fake news to the military, or he might do some kind of a wrong action, and suppose if he is caught, then he will suffer from the court martial, right? So while doing right or wrong kind of actions in a particular kind of environment, there is certain kind of a motive behind that purposeful kind of action that is there, what it is called as values. So when you say human, the ethical core values of the human, we normally talk about honesty, kindness, compassion. Okay, compassion is nothing but care for others. Okay, respect, personal responsibility of doing the things. These are some of the core ethical values of a human being, and it is applicable not only to me, it is applicable to you and other people, those who are there. Got the point? And these honesty, kindness, compassion, respect, and responsibility, other ways. Now see, in case of honesty, the question here is that how honest is that particular kind of a person in a given situation? Okay, so here I'm talking about when you are writing a research manuscript. So how honest you are there while writing a manuscript, or when you are performing any kind of experiment, or when you are collecting the data, how much honest you are while collecting the data, whether you are collecting a false data, or whether without collecting the data you are falsifying the data, or what you are doing. So it completely depends upon that particular kind of an individual human, and this behavior, it depends upon what kind of a values he has got. Okay, he might be pretending very honest from outside to the others, but probably he might be very dishonest. Okay, he might be pretending that he is very kind, but probably he might be unkind. Got the point? He might be pretending that he is caring for others, but probably he is not caring for the others. Got the point? So many things they are there. Got the point? You see the scenario. I will give you a very simple example. Just I think few days back in newspaper or somewhere in news, I saw that lot of fishes that are present in the lake or some river in the South India, they died and they were floating onto the water. Okay, And of course, it was because of some kind of a chemical pollution which was originated from a chemical industry which was released into that water body. And over a period of time, you will find that the fishes, because of depletion of oxygen and toxicity of that particular kind of a chemical, they all died and they started floating onto it. Okay. Now see, when you see this particular kind of a scenario as an incidence which have taken place, okay, or not only this particular kind of a scenario, or you might think about Bhopal gas tragedy and other kind of incidences as well. But I am giving you purposefully this particular kind of a example. So a human can behave, can think from the different perspectives of this particular kind of a issue. Okay. So, जैसे all the fishes they are floating onto the water, so one person might, when the incidence is being investigated, or one person, when many people they see this particular kind of accident or an incidence that have taken place, different people might have a different kind of a behavior, or they might have a different kind of a thought process here. Okay. Probably one may have a thought process that whatever it has happened, it is completely bad from the environmental point of view, because the industry should not release such kind of a toxic waste into the nearby water bodies. Okay, and they should do something about that particular kind of a wastewater in future, and which has killed so much of fish, and that water, it is no more now potable for the drinking purpose, and it has lost the fishes into it. So something concrete needs to be done in order to protect the environment as such. Okay, now such kind of a thinking could be only done who is pro environmentalist, okay, and who thinks it from the philosophical point of view. That person might also think that why this particular kind of a industry is throwing such kind of a waste into the environment. Okay, probably they may not be having that kind of a technology. Okay, चलो मान लिया technology नहीं है उनके पास, तो फिर is it necessary to throw away the waste like this? They would have stored it in a particular tank, or they would have transferred that particular kind of a waste to other safe place. Okay, for treatment. Got the point? And of course it has hampered that particular kind. So there is an economic loss for the fishermen who earlier used to catch the fishes, and now all the fishes they have died in that particular kind of a lake, right? So only a person with good ethical values, who has a good core values that are there, who has got a honesty, who is kind enough, who is compassionate enough, respect taking responsibility, might think from that particular kind of anchor. Okay. Other person might think that why I should get worried about it. Mera personal loss to isme kuch nahi hua, wo to fish mar gaye pani mein, right? Anyway, main to fish khata hi nahi hu. Okay, so he might think. So see, other person, his thought process is like this. Probably a third person might think something else. Got the point? A fourth person might think something else. रिपोर्टर क्या सोचेगा, अरे मुझे न्यूज मिल गया कि सो एंड सो इंडस्ट्री हैज रिलीज सच काइंड ऑफ अ वेस्ट एंड दैट सो मच, सो आई विल पुट अ फोटोग्राफ, माय एडिटर विल प्रेज मी एंड ऑल दिस पर्टिकुलर थिंग्स. ओके, बट ही विल नेवर ट्राई टू रिजॉल्व दैट पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ अ इशू, इवन दो ही हैज दैट पर्टिकुलर काइंड ऑफ अ कैपेबिलिटी एज फार एज रिजॉल्विंग सच काइंड ऑफ अ प्रॉब्लम्स इज कंसर्न्ड, राइट? सो इंसिडेंस इज वन एंड द सेम, बट डिफरेंट पीपल having so no two people they are same, but then difference of opinion is always there. Okay, but not from the core value point of view, right? So different people, they will think from the different perspective. In this particular case, some might think from the personal benefit point of view, some might think it from the environmental point of view, some might think from some other point of view. Got the point? So these core ethical values, it plays a very, very important role, and unless and until you have a core ethical values, you cannot ask philosophically a right research question to address through your research work. Okay, or isliye again and again I am telling you all guys, okay, ye abhi aapki PhD ki shuruaat hi hai, you are undergoing through the coursework. Okay, think from the philosophical point of view. Ask the right question. Have core ethical values, because these core ethical values of honesty, kindness, compassion, personal responsibility, respect, okay, these are very important values that you need to imbibe into you all. I am not claiming that you don't have that particular kind of a values. Definitely you have that. Okay. But उसमें भी है ना कि अभी ऑनेस्टी 80% है, 20% डिसऑनेस्टी है. गॉट द पॉइंट? सो व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू टेल यू इज दैट मुझे 80-20 वाला चीज नहीं चाहिए. ओके, आई डोंट वांट दैट 80-20 का रेशियो. आई वांट यू टू बी 100% ऑनेस्ट, 100% काइंड इनफ, 100% कंपैशनेट, 100% विद रिस्पेक्ट, आणि 100% ऑफ पर्सनल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी. Okay, so while doing research, think from the purest point of view. Then and then only you could do a good piece of research work and you can contribute to the existing body of knowledge, otherwise no. Okay, and I have told you a very important link between the philosophy and the core ethical values or the moral philosophy that is there. Okay, so this moral philosophy or ethics, normally there are three branches, and these three branches, they are like normative ethics, meta ethics, and applied kind of ethics. These are the branches of ethicals. We will not go into the detail, but just understand the concept of this normative ethics and meta ethics and applied ethics, which are three common branches of the moral ethics or the moral philosophy that is there. So in normative ethics, basically it practically means to determine a moral course of action in a given condition. So you have a condition in front of you, you have to solve a particular kind of a problem, and then what kind of a normative ethics that that you will use in order to find out the right answer to that particular kind of a question, which it means that because every problem is altogether different. Got the point? Like say, for example, dam preparation. Dams, we have so many dams in India, in every district. At every place you prepare a dam from the concrete. Okay, at some places you will find that dams are prepared from the other material. At some places you will find that stones are being used for dam preparation or construction. At some places you have to use hardcore concrete for that. Okay, you have to also see the geography there, the type of soil that is there, right? So even dams there, when they are constructed at different places, maybe in the same region, okay, so the different types of materials are being used. So that is a kind of a course of action that is there. Okay, and this course of action that is taken from the normative point of view, in other words, it is the ethical point of view or the, from the philosophical point of view. So you determine that what kind of action that will be taken in a practical sense for a particular kind of a problem or for a particular kind of a activity, what it is called as a normative type of a ethics that is there. So in other words, what you are doing is that you are understanding the merits of that particular kind of a scenario at that particular place, and as per the merit you are taking the course of action. So matlab merit ki baat kahan se aa gayi yahan, probably this question it might come into your mind. Matlab mera kehne ka matlab ye hai ki while selecting the materials for the construction of the dam at a particular location, you have to see the merits of that particular kind of a places. Okay, what kind of a topography that you have? Okay, what kind of a climate that you have? What is the amount of rainfall in that particular kind of area? Okay, what is the soil absorption capacity, water holding capacity of the soil in that particular area? What kind of a soil is available? What kind of a greenery or forest area that is available? What is the catchment zone? Okay, so what is the soil quality? So there are n number of parameters. Okay, so you have to each and every parameter on its merit, and you have to take a meritorious decision what is the moral course of action in order to resolve that particular kind of problem, what it is called as a normative ethics. Then you have a meta ethics. Okay, meta ethics, we have seen meta, even this meta philosophy in the philosophical aspects. So meta ethics, it talks, it is a theoretical meaning and the reference to moral kind of a what you can say propositions, and how their truth values if can be determined. So from the theoretical perspective, we actually find out what is the truth behind that particular kind of a proposition or that particular kind of a happening. So it is about the theoretical building that one needs to create. Okay, so when a thing, when a particular kind of a behavior it is happening in a particular kind of a community or a society, so from the theoretical point of view, one need to ask that why the society is behaving in a particular kind of a manner in this particular kind of a scenario. So you need to find out the truth values that are there through research, and then contribute to the overall meta ethics from the theoretical perspective. Okay, that is the meaning of meta ethics that is there. Okay, then you have the applied ethics. Applied ethics, it means that how the person behaves or what kind of a course of action he is taking in a specific kind of a situation. Okay, applied ethics, it is called as applied ethics. How the person is obligated, what kind of action it will take in a specific situation. Recently, Sushant Singh Rajput, he committed suicide. Got the point? So, usne suicide kyun kiya? So still we don't know the reason, but it was believed that probably he was taking drugs. We don't know whether he was really taking drugs or not, but then some of the people, they were pressurizing. So there are several theories behind that, and because of which he carried out the he conducted the suicide. Okay, abortion is being carried out by most of the females. Okay, so in a particular, when you land up in a specific kind of a situation, okay, how a person behaves in that particular kind of a situation, that particular kind of a scenario, it is called as a applied ethics. Okay, so it might be about suicide, it might be taking abortion, it might be maybe about a certain course of action. Okay, in the organization, behavior in the military, behavior in the hospital, and several other guys. So what kind of action you take? Suppose if the patient is in front of you, and if you are a doctor, then definitely if you are capable of treating him, then your action, applied ethics, there is that you have to attack. So it could be a good action, it could be a bad action as well. Okay, it depends upon that particular kind of a situation. And therefore, human behavior, it plays a very, very critical role, that even if you are frustrated, you should take a good course of action. Okay. And why I'm stressing more on this particular kind of a point, because y'all, you guys are doing PhD, or PhD mein, let me tell you that since I have done my PhD, and as I've told you that for, I did my PhD for a full time, my PhD was full time for 6 years, and I was under tremendous frustration, and you will find that the number of frustrations and the number of enjoyment points, if you calculate that, 70% was frustration and 30% was the enjoyment in my research work. Okay, so you will get frustrated points more as compared to your enjoyment points. Okay, but then you have to enjoy the those particular kind of a point to the fullest. You have to make it that 70% and reduce your frustration to 30%. Then and then only you could be able to complete your PhD work. क्योंकि पी एच डी वर्क में कैसा है कि बिकॉज यू आर एडिंग टू द एग्जिस्टिंग बॉडी ऑफ नॉलेज, यू आर डूइंग समथिंग न्यू बेस्ड अपॉन आइडेंटिफाइंग अप्रोप्रिएट गैप्स एंड रिसर्च क्वेश्चंस एंड यूजिंग अप्रोप्रिएट मेथोडोलॉजी बाय आइडेंटिफाइंग हाइपोथेसिस एंड अदर थिंग्स. बट देन यू विल रियल, ऐसे कई मौके आते हैं पी एच डी में कि यू गेट मोर फ्रस्ट्रेटेड रादर देन आपको आनंद हो उसके अंदर. लेकिन इन दैट फ्रस्ट्रेशन ऑल्सो देर इज लॉट ऑफ आनंद यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट ओके सो यू विल बी गोइंग थ्रू दिस अप्लाइड एथिक्स पार्ट ऑफ इट ओके यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड सो नो मैटर हाउ फ्रस्ट्रेटेड यू आर देर एट अ पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम डूइंग योर पी एच डी ओके always keep your ethical values very very strong and you will pass through that particular kind of a situation right you will not believe for my PhD for first 3 years I was not getting any results okay you can see my example itself I took 6 years for my PhD for first 1.5 years I was doing literature search for first 2 years I was doing some kind of experiment and the results which I got which was similar to my previous researchers so I thought that it is of no use to mera pehle 2.5 saal ka kaam aise hi chala gaya okay it was of no use because I was unable to publish that also because I was getting similar kind of a result what earlier researchers they were getting okay so I dropped that idea and took metal cyanide shifted to metal cyanide degradation over a period of time So, even after shifting to metal cyanide, I was not getting the result up to third year of my completion. To be more precise, it was 3.5 years. And after 3.5 years, so you can imagine that how much frustrated I would be at that point of time. Okay. And after 3.5 years, I started getting results. Okay. And then the next tension which came into my mind was that, अरे यार मैं इतना मेरा काम कर पाऊँगा कि नहीं? Okay, in the available fellowship, because fellowship cannot be more than 5 years. I was having fellowship for 5 years, but I took 6 years. For 1 year, I was without fellowship. So, still, I carried on. Okay, and I could do a good piece of research work, which ultimately gave me 5 good research papers, which I have already showed to you. 1 patent. What technology development and on the same PhD work I won the best PhD research award as well okay so you should take inspiration from me deliberately I have told you this particular kind of example because while doing the PhD work applied ethics plays a very very important role of course normative ethics comes on the second number and the meta ethics it is more of a research part of it right okay So this is a very important quote which is given by Albert Einstein, right? And what this quote says that morality is of the highest importance. Okay, so up to now, जो देखा, whatever that we have seen, it was all about morality and ethics and the values that are there. Because ultimately, the ethics and morality it comes from the individual behavior. Got the point? And then ultimately, it becomes a collective kind of behavior. So morality is of the highest importance, but for us, that is what he is saying. That for us means for human beings, not for the God. Okay, God, so he is the superpower. Okay, so you understand this very well, right? So it is about set of beliefs, practices, about how to lead a good life, doctrine, the value systems. That are there, and then there are 2 ways of this nature of moral judgment and reactions that are there. It is in a descriptive way and a normative way, which already I have explained to you. Okay, so descriptive way, normative way is that in a particular situation how you will take a decision. Descriptive ways they are nothing but the set of values that are there, right? So when you talk about the nature of moral judgments and reactions. There are 3 kinds of morals like moral judgment, moral arguments and moral principles. So when you talk about the moral judgments, it talks about good or bad actions against the standard good. So just a set of values, when you talk about the guiding principles, there are certain goods there. Uska ek koi standard hota hai. And in according to that particular kind of a standard, how your moral judgments are good and bad. Okay, so to put it more simply, If Usain Bolt can run 100 meters race in 9.7 seconds, okay, और उसी 100 मीटर को हम कितने सेकेंड्स में भागते हैं? Suppose if you are running at 11 or 12 seconds, then you can see that you can compare it with the Usain Bolt in that particular case, that how short you are there if you want to become a sprinter. Okay, so same thing is applicable for the researchers as well. Okay, moral arguments, they are based upon moral normativity and moral orders that are there. So basically research is all about the argument building kind of exercise, but this argument building should happen from the moral and ethical point of view, and that will happen only when you have a good core values into you, right? So you need to understand those particular things, and then you have a moral principles, rules of right conduct, counseling in a particular kind of a situation, in a particular situation, how one should behave. If you are not aware of that, then one can carry out the counseling on those particular areas. So right now I am delivering a lecture to you. It is a kind of a moral principles that I am teaching you. It is nothing but a counseling before you go ahead with your research journey. That is there. Okay. So when you say good as a word, it means that moral excellence. Okay. Something that is good by virtue, by credentials, and something is right which is conforming to the morality. Okay. So that is the difference between a good and right. Conforming. So it is a kind of a confirmatory test, in other words. What is right? If you are behaving according to the morality, then it is right. Okay. Now, these morality, suddenly it has not come from the air. Okay. This morality has come over a period of time from various segments of the society. Okay. What are these? It has come from community or society, parents, friends, your peers, teachers, because all these people, they have taught you certain things. Okay, kaise dusre ki respect ki jaye. Okay, how one should value others, how one should respect. Okay, how one should not harm to others, how one should provide the food, how you should be warmth, behave in a warmth way with the others. Okay, so your belief, religion, social norms, your relations, communications, and all these different segments that are there. So over a period of time, you will find that morality, the overall ethics, it has come from these. So these are the origins that are there. And when you say all these particular things, all great philosophers and researchers and scientists, they have played a very important role in this particular case, right? So Mahatma Gandhi has said a very important statement regarding the moral judgments or morality as such. Morality which depends upon the helplessness of a man or woman has not much to recommend it. Morality is rooted in a purity of hearts, of our hearts. Okay. See, Gandhiji himself is a very big example in itself. He did not do ahimsa. Because he was not having guns, or maybe he was not capable of doing himsa. Okay, he was capable of doing himsa, but a good man is such a man that in spite he is capable or he is potential of doing himsa, but he preached ahimsa among the people and he won the freedom for our country. Okay. So basically morality is not for the weak people. A bheek mangne wali cheez nahi hai, right? It is not begging. Okay, when you are poor and other kind of a things. Rather, it should come from your hearts, whether you are financially weak or whether you are financially strong. If your moral values, they are very, very strong, then nobody can stop you in that particular case, right? So when you talk about nature of moral judgments and reactions, there are certain basic moral principles which I have already explained. You need not to explain again. Do good, avoid evil, a very simple principle. Then the second important principle is golden rule, and probably some of you might be knowing this particular kind of a rule. Do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. Okay. This is one of the important principles of golden rule, which is given in the Christianity religion. Okay. इसका मतलब ये है कि ट्रीट अदर्स एज यू वुड लाइक अदर्स टू ट्रीट यू, ओके, पॉजिटिव और डायरेक्टिव फॉर्म ऑफ इट. डू नॉट ट्रीट अदर्स इन वे दैट यू वुड नॉट लाइक टू बी ट्रीटेड. वॉट यू विश अपॉन अदर्स यू विश अपॉन योर सेल्फ. गॉट द पॉइंट? तो मतलब यू नो ऑल दिस थिंग्स, सो आई विल नॉट एक्सप्लेन इट. द एंड डज नॉट जस्टिफाई द मीन्स. क्लासिकल फिलोसॉफी, दिस इज अ पार्ट ऑफ अ क्लासिकल फिलोसॉफी, राइट? You cannot do good things by unethical ways. Okay, it cannot be counted. You might be caught. Got the point? इसका मतलब मैं रिसर्च पेपर के मामले में बोलूँ तो what I would say is that if you publish a research paper in a good journal with a fake data or a falsified data, okay, if not now, so that is not justifiable, and if not now, one day you will get caught, right? So you need to have a strong ethical values in order to while doing the research work. That is the meaning there. So the end does not justify the means that is there. Follow what nature's law intends. Okay, and see, many of the nature laws we have not followed. That is the reason why we are facing so many problems that are there. Right? So nature's laws, they are very, very important, and one needs to understand the nature very well, right? Don't try to harm the nature. So I will end up with the ethical part of it, the via Brady quote given by Potter Stewart. Ethics is knowing the difference between what you have a right to do and what is right to do. Okay, so with this I will stop. So, any questions? So, have you understood everything what I have told you?
Fine, sir.
So with this we complete the introduction to philosophy and ethics that is there, and more details about the research and other aspect that we shall see from the next time. I have a session tomorrow also, but tomorrow, because of some unavoidable circumstances, I may not be engaging you, so I will engage with you in next week only. Tomorrow it is not possible for me. So probably Sir Dr. Satish Kumar, he might have arranged some other lecture to you. Okay. So if there are no questions, then should we close then? Or you have any questions? I am unable to hear you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.